I love exercise and I try to empower others to find the joy in this as well, because it's joyful. We don't want to think about exercise as drudgery and, oh no, I have to do this thing. Let's think about it as a joyful activity. And maybe by sharing with you some of the benefits of exercise and also the guidelines and how to reach these guidelines, you too will look at this as a joyful endeavor. United States Health and Human Services, back in 2008, they reviewed something like 8,600 studies. So these are scientists, exercise physiologists, clinicians, reviewing all this data to come up with a dose of exercise, because we do know exercise is medicine, but what's the dose we need to reap the benefits? From their research, they came up with these specific guidelines. Try to accumulate 150 minutes of moderate intensity physical activity each week. Moderate means that you can talk but not sing. If you can sing, you're in low intensity. You can also, if you're fit and actively engaged in exercising now, you may be doing vigorous intensity exercise. During that exercise, you can't even talk. If you are doing vigorous intensity exercise, then the guidelines are to accumulate 75 minutes in the week, so half that of the 150 of moderate intensity. If you want more health benefits, then you can go up to 300 minutes of moderate intensity or 150 minutes of vigorous intensity. And what are some of those more benefits? Well, a lot of people exercise because they actually want to clear their minds. They actually want to be more creative. And research shows that if you compare a 20-minute walk to 20 minutes of sitting, this is a great Stanford study that came out, after your 20-minute walk, you have an increase in divergent thinking by 60%. Divergent thinking is out-of-the-box thinking. So in order to reap these benefits, if you want more, you can do more exercise. We also know exercise can reduce blood pressure. It can also help endothelial cell function. It can increase HDL, and that's hard to do. Those high-density lipoproteins, it's hard to do that even with medications, but exercise is one of those things that can do that for us and help us prevent our number one killer of heart disease for ourselves. The other thing that it can do is increase insulin sensitivity. We know that diabetes is on the rise, and we want to try to address that for ourselves and for our patients. It can also increase fibrinolysis, so our clotting, so that we don't clot. Lower hypercoagulability so that we won't have a stroke. So all these things are so important for our bodies. I want to get back to the brain. I talked a little bit with you about creativity, but I like to get deeper into this. So when we exercise, there are certain neurotransmitters, natural chemicals that will rise. I don't know, some of you are familiar with these terms, but you may not associate exercise with them. Dopamine. Dopamine increases after we exercise. Of course, we feel that reward when we have dopamine. We also have motivation when we have a squirt of dopamine. It increases serotonin. We know serotonin reuptake inhibitors are what we use for depression. There are studies that show, compare exercise to an antidepressant to placebo. Wait 4 weeks, of course, because that's how long the antidepressant takes. And guess what? Serotonin levels go up the same with the antidepressant and the exercise, and depressive symptoms go down similarly in those two groups. So again, exercise really is medicine. And how much? 150 minutes accumulated over the course of a week of moderate intensity. What else? Norepinephrine increases. That helps us with attention. Many people are suffering with attention deficit, and this may well help you. Going out for a walk, a jog, could really help. We know about endorphins, the runner's high. You know that stretching also can release endorphins. That's a little trick and tip not many people know. We need to do our aerobic activity, we need to do our strength training, and we need to do our stretching.